Okay, so let's get started, right? This is our episode season two weekend learning with HDMD, right? HDMD is how to manage devices community. And today we are going to see Intune at a deeper level, right? Getting to know Intune at a deeper level. So Joy will be taking us through all the deep level troubleshooting and workflows of Intune service from a service perspective, right? How that works, etc., etc. Probably I would say you are the luckiest person. Probably you would be learning it directly from Joy, right? He has a lot of experience in Intune, and he did a lot of great work within Intune as a Microsoft. I don't know. I think he was escalation support engineer. He can correct me later if I was wrong. If I am wrong, right? So Joy, you want to say something?
Yeah, just so I was not an escalation engineer there in Microsoft. I was just a premier support engineer for Intune.
Yeah. So thank you for correcting me. So yeah, he was a support engineer in Microsoft, and he was doing great job over there. Now he's worker he's work he's working with a different organization, and he's doing Intune technical architecture related jobs over there. So he has a lot of experience in Intune, and he's going to show us all his experience, and he is going to help to learn Intune at a deeper level, right? So I'm not taking more time today, so I'll be directly handing over to Joy, and probably he can take over the session and go through his presentation probably. Over to you, Joy.
Yeah, sure, sir. Today, what I have planned to share with you in this session is something like not I can say that it's a troubleshooting, but it will help you in troubleshoot issues with Intune related to, because when you have a better knowledge of how Intune works in the backend and the flows, you would have a better knowledge of knowing where the breakpoint is and whether the issue is within the scope of Intune or not. Because most of the time, what we get to see is when we are managing a device and reports an issue, so the issue might not be because of Intune itself. It might be because Intune as a service collaborates with a lot of other services, like O365 services and other services. So the issue might be from there end. But we need to understand what the scope of Intune is and what it actually does, and that is what this session will be all about. So I will start sharing my screen. Just let me know when it's visible.
It's okay for me, Joy.
Okay. So I will just start shortly, just a minute. So today we will be going at a deeper level with Intune, and the first thing that comes with Intune is the enrollment. We enroll the device to get it managed. So we have a device here. Say first I'm starting with the mobile devices. So what we do is we install the company portal app from the Play Store, or if that is an iOS or an Apple device, then from the Apple App Store. Now, why we need this agent? Because this agent is basically the OMADM client of the device. Now, when we say about OMADM client, it is the protocol, the OMADM, Open Mobile Alliance Device Management Protocol, is the protocol on which a DM server or a device management server communicates or instructs a device to manage its features. Now, by default, the mobile devices have a OMADM client inbuilt, and that is how it gets the manufacturer or the OEM updates over the air, OTA updates from the manufacturer. But that particular OMADM client that the device comes inbuilt with is specifically tagged to the OEM only, and other services cannot use that. So we require a DM client of the MDM solution itself. So every MDM solution has their own client implementation. So for Intune, that is the company portal lab. The first stage of enrollment that we do is, it's divided into stages. So I will break the enrollment into the stages of how a device finally gets enrolled. The first step is the client initialization. And when we talk about client initialization is when we download the company portal app, install it, and open it for the first time. What it does when we open it for the first time is, it reaches out to the platform push notification services. So for Google, that would be FCM, Firebase Cloud Messaging Services. For Apple, that is the APNS. And to manage Apple devices, we already know we need to bind our Intune services with the APNS. So it goes ahead and registers with the platform notification services, and it retrieves a registration token for that. And this token is will be cached by the company portal app and will be later used. After it retrieves the PNS token, it does a discovery of the location services, where it goes ahead and checks the endpoint to connect to the Azure services. Once it retrieves the endpoint is when it does the authentication and the authorization, that is, you get the login screen, you type in your credentials and do the authentication. If the authentication is a success, then you get an ID token and an access token in return, which the company portal app will later use to do the Azure AD registration of the join. So for a mobile device, it's always a registration. For Windows devices, it can be a registration or a join. So it will go ahead and do the Azure AD registration, which is basically known as the device registration service or the Azure DRS process. And once the registration of the join is successful, then it will go ahead for the MDM enrollment. So enrollment happens at the last stage, and during this enrollment, it will also forward the push notification token, the registration token it received from the push notification services, and it will send it to Intune, so that later on when Intune needs to connect back to the device, it can use that notification services to reach out to the notification platform and send a push to the device so that it can go ahead and connect with Intune. Now, this is a high level view of the entire process of enrollment for a device. In the later slides, like as we go on, I will be breaking down these parts into the authentication, the registration, and the MDM enrollment. So let's see how the authentication works. So the authentication basically works on the MSAL or the MS authentication library, which was previously known as the ADAL, Azure Active Directory Authentication Library. What it does is, we open the company portal app and it does the registration, and it then provides us with the sign in page, is where it is basically sending a get command to Azure to get the OpenID configurations to receive the endpoints, the authentication endpoints. With that authentication endpoint received, it will build a sign-in request to obtain the ID token. The ID token is basically, you would need an ID token, because without a token, you cannot go ahead and access the services. This is when how that looks like. So it's again a GET command, and you would see that it is going to OAuth, the authorized endpoint, where it is requesting for an ID token. The response type equals to ID token, and the scope is the open ID. So when we say that what are the authentication protocols that like Microsoft services are using in the backend, if it is being handled by Azure, so if Azure is your authentication endpoint, then it is always using the OAuth 2 with the OpenID Connect protocols. If it is going to ADFS or if it is a pass-through authentication where Azure AD is leveraging your on-premises Active Directory, then it's a SAML-based authentication as well. So when this sign-in request is built is when you get this sign-in page in the company portal where you get to type in your work account details. Now, as you type your work account, there is a small process that happens. You will see a dot, a moving lines of dot there, which is the home realm discovery. So it discovers whether that particular domain exists with Microsoft or not. At that moment of point, it is not checking the user. So if you see it, it raises a get command again to check the user realm, whether it exists or not. And based on this, the response to this get command will provide information to the company portal app whether it will go to Azure STS to do the authentication. STS is the secure token services for Azure, or whether it will go to ADFS, the next sign-in page or the password page, it will be redirected to your ADFS or not, or if it is going to your pass-through authentication, that is your local AD, and will do a Kerberos-based authentication or not. Irrespective of where the redirection will be, when the user completes the sign-in is when you get the ID token back. Now, the entire motive behind this slide is to let you know that, say, when we are doing an authentication and say we are failing an authentication, most of the time the tickets come to Intune that if the user cannot enroll the device, it is not going past the authentication screen. In this entire flow, Intune is not engaged. It's your authentication endpoint that is engaged, so you should be better engaging your Azure Identity team or maybe your ADFS team if it is being redirected to ADFS to check whether the claim rules of the ADFS are well configured, whether the WS trust points are configured to support the enrollment. And if it is going to your Active Directory, then you have your on-prem Active Directory or identity services to check whether the Active Directory is providing Azure with the TGT token or the ticket gaining token, based on which it will Azure will create the ID token and send it back to the company portal app. The ID token that is received is a response of this particular get command where it is asking for the authorize. So it's a response. And if you do, so how do you see this flow actually? So I'm telling you that it's a get command here and a get command there. So how do you see that? If you take a network trace of your device while you are doing an enrollment, you would be able to see all of this. This is the response that is returned back to the company portal app, where it gives the company portal app an access token, a refresh token, and an ID token. And it also states the expiry, like when this token will expire. And this is always a bearer token, so it's added to the HTTP header. So if you are doing a Fiddler trace or a, say a Netmon trace or maybe Wireshark, you would be seeing this in the HTTP authorization header. In the response type, it's an application JSON type. Now we are particularly, so here comes that there are three types of token that are mentioned here: the access token, the refresh token, and the ID token. Access token is basically the token which will give you access to which will give you access to the services, whereas a refresh token is used to refresh the access token. So access token validity is it's a short-lived token. Validity of access token is like 1 hour or 2 hour maybe, but once that token like expires, if there is no refresh token, then you would be asked to re-login or re-authenticate with the services. But the refresh token helps to do that silently in the backend, like where the refresh token is sent to the service to get a new access token. but the access token or the refresh token does not actually contains information about the user. It's the ID token which contains the user information. And basically the ID token is a JSON web token. And this is how the structure of ID token is. And in a more elaborate way, this is what you actually get to see in an ID token. So the header, it informs the type of the token, that it is a JWT. It will also show you the algorithm that was used to generate the token and the key ID for the public key, which was used to sign this token. The payload will contains the information for the audience. The audience here refers to the application to which the token is being generated. It also states the issuer, who is the issuer of this token, and the issued at time, the not before time, and the expiry of this token time, with the authentication method matrix. So what authentication type was used, whether it was a password-based authentication, or a MFA, or a RSA, like a certificate-based authentication. Then it also gives you the app ID. And the CNF is a opaque thing. It is not actually visible, so you cannot decode that particular thing, but it's internal to Azure. And at the end, it will finally give you the user details, so for which user this token is being generated to. For mobile devices, this is what the token looks like. But for Windows devices, there are three more parameters that are included into the token payload. And those are the MDM terms of use URL, the MDM enrollment URL, and the user setting sync URL. This is basically what you configure in the MDM and the MM scope. So when we say like for auto enrollment to work, you need to set your MDM scope properly so that it does not conflict with the MM scope. This is the reason why, because the token will contain the information of the enrollment URL or the discovery location of your enrollment endpoints. And based on this, say if your device is getting the MAM URL, then it will do a MAM only enroll. If it is getting a MDM URL, it will do the MDM enroll. And finally, the signature. And the validity of a OAuth 2 access token is 1 hour. And the token remains valid till expiry, and the token cannot be revoked. But the validity of a refresh token is 90 days and can be customized. And it can be revoked by the admin or if the user resets their password via the SSPR. Now, that is why when we say when we apply conditional access or when we do anything that depends on the services, we say it takes some time for the new configuration to take effect, because the access token that was previously gained by the user before the policy was applied will still be valid, and it will, and the new policies will be enforced only when that access token expires, and the refresh token will be used to get a new access token which will contain the new restrictions. So if I just quickly show you something, so how do you get this is something like if you are doing a trace of your device, you get the something like this, the AAD user token, where you can copy the data from here, or you can even get it from the network traces of the device, and you just go ahead and decode it with a JWT decoder that is available online. And if you paste the base64 URL encoded data here, you get the entire structure of the token. So that is how I'm showing it to you. So based on this, now let's say like the authentication is successful, my company portal app has now received the ID token, the access token, and the refresh token.
So Joy, I have a question over here. Just can you go to the last slide? Yeah, so in payload we have the authentication process, right? The password, RSA, and MFA. So which one the user is using, can we get it from here?
Yeah, so this what I have mentioned here is the basic. So if you see, I have used this as a generic. So if you are using the password-based authentication, then AMR value will only contain PWD. It will not contain the RSA or the MFA. But I'm here, I have just mentioned all the possible values that are there in the AMR.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Yeah. Next is we have the token now. So what company portal app will do is for Android devices, it will go ahead and do a workplace joint discovery, which is discovering the Azure AD registration URLs. And based on that, once the endpoints are retrieved, it will do the workplace joint. Now the workplace join in this process, what it does is the device generates a key pair, a RSA key pair, public key, private key pair, with which the device will create a certificate sign-in request and send it to Azure. When Azure receives the certificate sign-in request from the device, based on that, it will create a device object in Azure AD. And a certificate will be returned back to the device, and that certificate or the subject name of that certificate refers to your Azure AD device object GUID. And WPJ success is like your device has received the Azure AD device ID certificate. If it's a failure, then again it's a failure from the Azure DRS process, and Intune is not involved here for Android as of now. For iOS devices, the process is a bit different. So before it actually goes ahead and do the workplace join, it will first reach out to Intune to request for the management profile. And this is where the first SCIP certificate gets pushed to the device, where you first install the management profile and then continue with the process of company portal app. And then it does basically the same process there. It does the workplace join discovery, it does the workplace join where it sends the certificate sign-in request to Azure. Azure will create a certificate and the device object in Azure AD and will send back the certificate which identifies the Azure AD device object. So for Android, it's a direct thing. For Apple, it first reaches out to Intune to get the management profile. Because Apple is a closed ecosystem, without Intune delivering the management profile, nothing will be trusted from a third-party services. And that is the entire motive of the management profile, which states that all the sources coming from the Microsoft services should be trusted by this device. For a Windows device, I will go a bit deep, because for mobile devices, it's the company portal app that is handling everything. The company portal app being the DM client, it's handling everything. But for Windows devices, we know that for enrollment, we do not require the company portal app, because Windows 10 is built from scratch to be managed via cloud, and it has all the MDM protocol stacks inbuilt into its OS. Sorry for that. So if we
Sorry,
talk
about one question about this, the workplace join, is it like the hybrid Azure AD join or what it is?
For a mobile device, the workplace join, it means the Azure AD registration. You cannot join or join your device or mobile device to Azure, because eventually at the end of the day, you won't be logging into the mobile with Azure account. It's only registering the device.
So if you have applications, or if you have SharePoint or Teams or anything that have a policy which says that only managed devices are allowed, what does that mean for a mobile device then?
Managed devices allowed means the device should be managed by a service like an MDM service, where the MDM will evaluate the compliance of the device and will report that to Azure, because compliance is a feature of Azure device object. And based on that, you define your conditional access, whether the service should be accessible by the device or not.
So a Windows device will be managed device if it is just joined to Azure AD, and a mobile device could be managed device if it doesn't even join to the Azure AD, is that correct?
A Windows device can be managed device whether it is Azure AD registered, or whether it is Azure AD joined, or whether it is Azure AD hybrid Azure AD joined. The basic fundamental thing here is that you cannot join your mobile devices. A mobile device only supports registration where you add your work or school account. But on your Windows devices, you can do both. You can register your devices where you would still be signing into Windows using your local account, or you can Azure AD join it where you will be signing it with your Azure AD credentials, or you can do a hybrid Azure AD join where you would be signing in on your device with your local AD account.
A registered device is a managed device?
A registered device is also a managed device, yes. The management does not depend on whether it is registered or joined. The management depends on whether it is enrolled or not.
So probably this, Vivek, sorry, Joy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Probably Vivek, Vibhak, right? So Vibhak,
yeah.
if you have more questions, probably we can take at the end of the session. If that's okay with Joy, you are okay with that? Join?
Yeah,
sure,
I'm
sure.
Fine with that.
Okay.
But getting it cleared that registration or join is a process that is required for the device to get enrolled. Windows also supports your device to get enrolled to Intune without even doing Azure AD registration or join. So that's the MDM only enrollment option. But such a device is not considered a managed device, because it will not be able to apply conditional access on that, on that kind of thing.
Sure, thank you. Maybe I can get back to you at the end of the session.
Yeah, sure. So for a Windows device, if we break down the OS into a basic level of high level overview, then this is what it looks like. So there is the hardware which is sitting at the bottom, over which there is the hardware abstraction layer or the HAL, over which the OS kernel sits, and then there is the user space or the user runtime space. And there is a difference between the kernel space memory and the user space memory, which is addressed via the translated memory space. And if a user space application needs to connect with the kernel space memory, then there would be a remote procedure call or RPC call made. But what is more interesting is that in Windows, the thing that runs your out-of-box experience, or maybe if your device is already provisioned and you are going to settings, accounts, access work or school, and from there you are clicking on that connect to work, what basically runs in behind is the cloud experience host process, which runs the cloud domain join web app. Now this is the client that is performing the actions of the company portal app on a Windows device. And basically this web app makes a call or a RPC call to the dsrec.dll. This is the DLL which has all the functions that are required for a device to get joined or registered to Azure. So if you do a DLL explorer for dsrec.dll, you will see that these are all the functions available for this particular DLL file, where it will start the discovery, which is the begin discover function, and then based on the endpoints that are received as a response to that get command for the discovery, it will send the join request to Azure. Now it will also include the ID token, the discovery URL, and the access token in the payload, so that Azure knows that this is coming from a valid user or a valid device. You can actually see this in your Windows devices. If you go to your events and under user device registration, you will see that the discovery request send operation was successful. And this is what the response that is returned in return to this particular request, where you will see that the device will be provided back with the endpoints to where the device can then send the join request. So there is another event ID 103, where the join request was sent, and this is the certificate that Azure AD sends back to the device in response. And this certificate, as I said, is the subject name of the certificate, or the CN, refers to the Azure AD device object. So if you go and check on your device personal store, you will see certificates issued by Azure to the device after the end of the Azure AD join or registration process, Now, whether it be it Azure AD registration or Azure AD join, you would get this certificate. The registration and the join only differs in the functionality or the mere fundamentals, that if you're registering the device, you would be logging into the system using your local account or a Microsoft account maybe. But if you're joining the device, you would be signing in with your Azure AD credentials. So the join is now success and dsrec.dll has the success code returned by Azure. So what it will do is, for the enrollment now, it will go ahead and invoke the device enroller.exe, which is the function or the program already present in Windows. This dsrec.dll or the device enroller.exe or whatever programs I'm telling you will find this under C Windows System 32. So these are all system files or system programs. So once the device enroller is invoked, the device enroller does not initiate enrollment request with Intune instantly. Instead, it will invoke the OMADM client, and the OMADM client will request for a notification channel from the notification platform, which is the Windows Notification Services in case of Windows. So a channel URI is returned to the OMADM client, which is returned to the device enroller.exe, and with that the device enroller will go ahead and send a enroll request to Intune. The process is same. The device generates a certificate sign-in request and sends it to Intune, and Intune will create a certificate or a device object in Intune and send it back to the device. And the same as the Azure AD join process or the registration process, the subject name of the certificate refers to the Intune device object. So after a enrollment, a successful enrollment, whether you are doing Azure AD join or Azure AD register for a Windows device, you would see two certificates there in your certificate store. One is from the Azure and one is from the Microsoft Intune MDM device CA. And there is a third certificate also delivered, that is a peer-to-peer access certificate, which allows you to get RDP connections of your Azure AD join devices. Once the enrollment is complete is when the Intune sends the bootstrap command to the OMADM client. The bootstrap is basically binding the OMADM client to contact with Intune only, post which the OMADM client will initiate a device management session with Intune, and then Intune will send the policies. And for the future mode, if Intune needs to communicate with the device, it will register a push with the notification services, which in the same way will invoke the OMADM client to initiate a DM session. Now, whatever I talked about in this slide falls in the ESP phase, first phase, that is the device preparation. There are four steps here. You see that the securing your hard drive or hardware is basically taking ownership of the TPM, which is not covered in this process. That is a separate thing where it generates the AIK for the TPM and takes the ownership, and post which it does the Azure AD join, which is the joining your organization's network. Registering your device for the mobile management is the enrollment, and preparing your device for the mobile management is the bootstrap process, where the client will initiate the DM session to get the list of policies that would be tracked in the further phases of the ESP. So this completes the MDM enrollment process. Now I will go into the autopilot thing a bit, because there's still a lot many confusions with the autopilot. So how the states of a device changes during the autopilot flow is the main motive behind this slide. The first thing is that we register the hardware hash of the device with the Windows Autopilot services. Now this can be done manually by us running the PowerShell script extracting the hardware hash, or this can be done by the partners as well using their particular tools or the OEMs. But whatever be that, so when we are registering a device to the Autopilot service, that the service you can consider as a database. So within the database, there would be a table and you are creating a new row. Now, to within a database table, if you have to uniquely identify your row, we would need a primary key, and that primary key for Autopilot device is its ZTD ID. So it can also be the order ID or the purchase ID, but most preferably we use the ZTD ID. And once the device is registered, what the Autopilot service do is it goes ahead to Azure and creates a blank device object with the ZTD ID stamped on that object. At this present moment, the device object is disabled. It's not in an enabled state. The name of the device object is the serial number of the device. It will have the Azure AD device ID, but it will not have an Intune device ID at this moment because the device had not started the process of provisioning. And because of the creation of this device object, that you create a dynamic device group with the query like a device.device physical ID contains any ZTD ID, this device becomes a member of that group to where you from Intune will be deploying your profiles and policies so that the device gets it. So what happens if at this current moment, this device is a blank object and it is in a disabled state. So if you delete this device object, the device will not become a member of the group. It will not get the profiles and policies. So when you start the provisioning, it will not go through the Autopilot flow. And also this creation of this ZTD ID stamping on the device ID is a one-way communication. So it can only be done via the Windows Autopilot services when the device is registered. In such cases, when you if you do not see the Azure AD device object of your device containing the ZTD ID stamping, means you have deleted the initial object that was created, and the only way to get it back is to delete the device from the Autopilot service and re-register it back so that it will create that again. So now say the device has started the provisioning process. I am going from a high level again because I will go into the breakdown into the parts later on. So it will do the Azure AD join first, or so Autopilot will obviously do a Azure AD join or a hybrid Azure AD join. The hybrid will be covered in a different scenario, but let's talk about the Azure AD join. The join request that the device will send, the join request will instruct the device not to create a, or instruct Azure to not to create a new device object, but it will refer to this blank device object that is already pre-existing in Azure. So what Azure will do is Azure will now change the state of this device object to enabled, and it will give the generic Windows name to the device and send the certificate back to the device when the device will start doing the enrollment process with Intune. So similarly, Intune will generate the Intune device object, and this device object will now point to the enabled Azure AD device object. And the final state of the AAD device object will reflect the AAD device ID, the Intune device ID, as well as it will have the ZTD ID stamping. And in future, if you want to go ahead and reprovision the device, you can just do a reset or initiate an Autopilot reset event from the portal, because the device will still be a member of the dynamic group that you have created based on the ZTD ID. It will get the policies and profiles again. So how does it work is first we start a device. The first pages of the out-of-box experience screen is basically selecting your region and keyboard, after which it will ask you to connect to a network. If you are already connected via LAN, then it does not ask you to connect to a network and this page is skipped. But what happens is when you connect to the network, the device first initiates a connection to the licensing.mp.microsoft.com endpoint to check the Windows activation status of the device, whether Windows is activated or not. Simultaneously, it reaches out to the Windows update endpoint to check for the 0-day patches or the UUBE ZDP updates. So at this point of the time, the device will not be provided with any quality or feature updates, but it will only be provided with the, the important security patches or that must be there. and simultaneously it reaches out to endpoint known as account.live.com, and you can also see an endpoint like a login.live.com, where the device sends it hardware hash again. And this basically endpoint is the Windows Autopilot Services endpoint, where it will redirect it to the ztd.dds.microsoft.com and cs.dds.microsoft.com. So the Windows Autopilot Service code name is Device Directory Service, and Device Directory Service is basically the short form for the DDS, from where the device will download the profile, the autopilot profile. And once the profile is downloaded, this time the device does not need to do any discovery, because the autopilot profile will provide all the information to the device to which tenant this device is being configured to. So it will directly move and show you your customized login page, that is your company branding. From there, it will go ahead and do the authentication and the Azure AD join. So basically, if you have also assigned a user to the device from Intune, then it does not ask you to enter your username, but it will directly ask you to provide your credentials, and it will do the authentication and the join that I told earlier. So it follows the same process. Once that is done, it will enroll to Intune, and Intune will send the initial policy to the device, which will be tracked via the ESP. And once the policies are completely set up, or what you have configured your ESP to track for, once that is done and ESP returns a success to Intune, it will provide you with a login screen and desktop. So that is the basics of Windows Autopilot. So when we say that my autopilot is failing, so you need to be very clarified about the thing. What is actually failing, whether it is the Azure AD join that is failing or the Intune enrollment that is failing. Because if you are receiving the customized provisioning flow, means your autopilot is actually successful because it is delivering what is there. But then the device may fail at the Azure AD join steps because of numerous reasons. It can fail the Intune enrollment because of numerous reasons. So you need to do a troubleshooting of that. But in general, if you say my autopilot provisioning is failing, you need to be very much specific about what is actually failing. So as it is stated by Microsoft, like the Windows Autopilot is a collection of services. So it's the registration of the devices to the DDS service. It's the Azure AD DRS process, which will perform the join. And it's the Intune enrollment. So any of those processes may have any number of breakpoints. So you need to be specific about what the breakpoint is, instead of generally saying that my autopilot is failing. And you can get the information of the failures from the events. There is only if it's related to your join thing, then you get that from the user device registration events. If it is failing with the Intune enrollment, you would get that from the device management enterprise provider events. So this is what the autopilot profile basically contains, and so it gives you back the AAD device ID. It will tell the device the configuration. So this cloud assigned UUB config is basically the customization of the out of box experience that we are doing, which screens are omitted and which screens are allowed to come up. And this value of 28, so basically there would be two values only you would be seeing. 28 is for the admin user profile, and whereas 30 will be the standard user profile. The cloud assigned domain join method tells your Windows 10 device that what join this profile will be doing. So 0 is for Azure AD join, 1 is for hybrid Azure AD join. And then it will be doing, say, whether auto enrollment is enabled or not, and what is your tenant domain, what is the tenant ID, and what is the tenant MDM ID for that, and the profile name, and all the information. So you get that. Till Windows 1809, the autopilot profile was saved to the location of C Windows Provisioning Autopilot. but there has been a change with 1903. So any Windows 10 running 1903 and above, the autopilot profile is downloaded to the C Windows service state autopilot location. Previously, with 1809 or till 1809, there was only one profile that was delivered to the device, but with 1903 and above, there are actually two profiles or configuration JSON files that are provided. One is the autopilot concierge file and the other is the autopilot DDAZTD file. Now, basically, your autopilot setting is there in the autopilot DDAZTD file. The concierge file is for customization of the out-of-box screen initial language and all those account setup things, but it is still not used yet. So there might be Microsoft might be working on that later on with the later parts of Windows. So currently, it's only the autopilot DDAZTD file that is being used. Now we will move to the hybrid Azure AD autopilot flow because it's different. So the profile is downloaded to the device. So like I have started the provisioning connected to the network and I have downloaded the profile now. So what the device will do, it will not go ahead and do a Azure AD join because it's a hybrid Azure AD join. So what it will do is it will reach out to Intune to request for the offline domain join blob. And simultaneously till at this point of moment, it also starts to randomly ping to check a DC availability. Because hybrid Azure AD join till now requires a direct line of sight to your DC. I know the VPN connectivity option is now in public preview and I will talk about that later. So if you remember my last slide, the autopilot profile also contains the highlighted red property hybrid join skip DC connectivity check set to zero. So the autopilot profile will tell the device whether it should do a DC connectivity check or whether it should skip the DC connectivity check. So for the VPN thing, it will definitely skip the DC connectivity check. So Intune, it sends a request to Intune to request for the ODJ blob. It also checks the availability of the DC, but at this moment the device doesn't know what domain to contact to, but it's just a random spray of ping to check whether a DC is available or not. What Intune does is Intune reaches out to your domain Active Directory via the ODJ connector and it requests for the device blob. So the connector will create a device object in your AD in the OU specified when you configured the ODJ connector. It will send the blob back to Intune and Intune will send it back to the devices when the device will perform the join and restart back. So at this point, the device completed the domain join. But there is still, it is yet to complete the Azure AD registration. So there is no entry in Azure as of now. But the device starts to do a registration request to Azure, and you can see this in the user device registration events that such request gets a failed error event because Azure has no information of this device as of now. The Azure AD Connect, which is the responsible object or maybe the responsible entity to sync the device to Azure from your local Active Directory, it waits till a particular property of the device is updated in the AD. And that particular property is called the user certificate property of the device object. Now, so what the device will do is it will reach out to the DC again to query the SCP or the service connection point to get the AD tenant info. The domain will reply back to the device providing the AD tenant info when the device will create a self-signed certificate and update the user certificate property of itself in the domain. Now, when this particular property of the device object is updated, based on the sync cycle, if the Azure AD Connect has already completed this recent sync, it will wait till 30 minutes by default to do the next sync. And it will go ahead and sync the device to Azure is when a device object will be created in Azure. And when Azure will now receive a register request from the device. Azure will respond back with the AAD device certificate. At this moment, the device just received the AAD device certificate, but it has not yet received the PRT or the primary refresh token. So for that, you need to sign out and sign in to retrieve the PRT. This is where the second login comes in for the hybrid Azure AD flow. In a Azure AD join, we only log in for the first time or single time, but in a hybrid Azure AD join flow, there are two login prompts, if you remember that. So this, the second login prompt is for to retrieve the PRT. Now, once the PRT is retrieved by the device, based on the, maybe like you have set the auto enrollment from Intune, or maybe you are doing enrollment to Intune via the GPO, whatever that is, it will enroll to Intune, and it is then when Intune sends the policies to the device. So this entire process basically is time consuming, as you can see that before the device actually gets to Azure, there is a lot of activities that are dependent on the device to complete on the on-premises. And if your ESP is not configured to allow such delays, time delays, then what we most see with hybrid Azure AD join, that your ESP times out and results in a failure where you have to restart the process all over again. And even if you do that, it will still fail out because it's still waiting for that same time of delay. That is where, why for the hybrid Azure AD join, we either max out the ESP timeout to allow this 30 minutes of delay between the sync, or we skip the user ESP phase. So the device completes the device ESP phase, but we skip the tracking of the policies tracking via our OMA URI, where we instruct the device that not to wait in the ESP for the policies, but it will come down to the devices later on in the background. So just like I showed the device object of autopilot for Azure AD join flow, similarly we will see that how it is for a hybrid Azure AD join flow, and what are the states of the device object in Azure, and why we say that we need to target the policies to the hybrid Azure AD device object instead of the original device object. So it's basically the same funda when we go ahead and create or register the device to Windows Autopilot services. It will go ahead and create a Azure AD device object. Now this device object will not be a hybrid Azure AD device object. Even if your Autopilot profile is configured to do a hybrid Azure AD join, the device object that Windows Autopilot service will instruct Azure to create, it will always be Azure AD only. And it will have the name as the serial number, the AAD device ID, Intune device ID will be blank, and had the ZTD ID stamped on, and the state is disabled. Since the device, and based on this device object, actually you create the dynamic group, and again to which you deploy the profiles and policies, for which the device will get the autopilot profile when it starts the provisioning. But from here, the process moves away from what was the normal Azure AD join. In case of the normal Azure AD join, the device would now do a Azure AD join request to with the same Azure AD device object. But in case of hybrid Azure AD join, it never does the Azure AD join here. So it instead goes to the local Active Directory and joins the domain. The ODJ blob is sent to the Intune that I have omitted here, but it basically does the domain join. And then Azure AD Connect syncs that device object to Azure. Now this Azure AD Connect has no idea of the existing AAD device object that is already existing in Azure. So what Azure AD Connect does is it creates a new device object, which is the hybrid Azure AD device object. At this point of time, the pre-existing device object, which was created because of the autopilot registration, it goes into a stale state, because this device object will never be used again. It goes into a stale state, and as soon as this hybrid Azure AD device object is also created, Intune stops targeting its policies to the device based on that initial device object. So Intune will now do and target its policies based on this new hybrid Azure AD device object, and do the Intune enrollment, which will point to this particular hybrid AD device object. So this works for the first time. Now just consider the fact that the device was assigned to some other user and that user has left, and you will now reprovision the device and assign it to someone else. Since Intune has stopped targeting the profile policies to the device object that was previously based on the autopilot device object, the device at this point of time will not receive the profile, and it will also not receive the ODJ blob because Intune has not targeted that to that particular group. So what you need to do for your hybrid Azure AD joined devices is maybe you can create a dynamic device query based on the computer naming convention that you apply to your devices to contain the hybrid Azure AD device objects, or at least the domain join profile that you create in Intune should be targeted to all devices. So even if you reprovision your hybrid Azure AD join device, it would still get the policy irrespective of whether Intune is targeting it to the Azure AD device object or the hybrid Azure AD device object. So this basically completes the autopilot and the hybrid autopilot as well flow. Now I will be talking about management of the devices in particular. So when we talk about management, we are managing a device. So what we are managing? We are basically managing a particular features of the device. And in order to manage those features, they needs to be exposed via an interface or an API for an MDM solution to be able to manage them, right? Because without an interface, we cannot actually go ahead and connect to those particular nodes and manage or configure or modify their settings. This basically is what Windows 10 do, is the exposing or exposure of the features that a device has is via the configuration service providers. So configuration service providers exposes the features that can be managed by a MDM solution. How does it looks like is like it always starts with a .vendor/msft. Now there it can be a .device/vendor/msft. If there is a .device, it means the policy is coming, it's a device targeted policy. If it's a .user, then it's a user targeted policy. And then it will have the different management areas, like AppLocker may be a management area, BitLocker may be a management area, policies, accounts, and EDP, and all those. So there are lots of CSPs that are actually there, and each of this particular management area will have different capabilities or different parameters that can be configured. Now if we look into this, it gives us the device management tree. So this forms the device management tree, by which we means like all the management features and capabilities of a device that a MDM solution can manage. And the parameters that can be configured are called the management objects, and MDM solution is basically interested in configuring those things. So Intune is basically interested in retrieving the management objects so it can set the values or maybe reset those values as well. Now, so this is how MDM solution works. So whether be it Intune or any other MDM solution, it will, for Windows 10 device, it will work via the configuration service providers. Consider that you have on-prem management capability as well, and you want to control the MDM management features from your on-prem or legacy management thing. So that is where your WMI comes in, or the Windows Media Instrumentation, if I'm not wrong. There is a bridge provider, MDM bridge WMI provider, which basically connects to the WMI namespace or CIM namespace of DNMAP, and it maps to the configuration service providers. So if you want to manage your MDM policies from on-premise, you basically use the MDM Bridge WMA providers. Now, these configuration service providers, you can actually compare it with the group policy client-side extensions, because that is how, when you create a group policy in your AD and you want to manage your device, it's the client-side extensions which applies those policies on the device. So client-side extension acts as a interface for the group policies to be applied on the device. Similarly, configuration service providers acts as the interface for MDM solution to manage the devices. And if you have both, which is mostly in the case of a hybrid Azure AD Joint system where you have group policy as well as MDM policies, if there is a particular settings that you are managing with both in tune, say a MDM or a group policy, there are chances of a policy conflict, which you can also control. There is a MDM OMA URI that you need to configure under the policy CSP, which states that MDM wins over group policy. You can set the value so that if there are any such instances where a MDM policy and a group policy is conflicting, the MDM policy will win. You can set that. This is basically how it works on the entire Windows 10 management. So when I'm talking about Windows 10 management, because it gives us this much level of access to actually retrieve the informations for our mobile devices, we cannot actually show this because it's the company portal app which is doing everything on the device. It the company portal app there on the mobile device acts as the token broker, where it is keeping your access tokens and refresh tokens. It is also acting as the OMA DM client, retrieving the instructions, and it is also performing the device level instructions, what it is receiving by invoking those particular OS features. But for Windows, it's easy to get this view. But in case of mobiles as well, there is a DM tree and there are management objects which Intune actually does. So it's same for every platform. I'm just showing it for Windows. And the next thing is the most important thing is the how Intune client communication model works, or the communication between the MDM server and the managed devices. So if I started with telling that when we enroll the device, the first stage of that is the company portal app registers with the push notification platform to get a registration token. It is same for Windows as well, where it gets the channel URI from the platform notification services, which it then sends to Intune. So whenever we as an admin make any changes to the Intune policies, or what Intune does, it Intune will generate a push to the push notification services, and it will mention the registration token that it received from the device during the enrollment. So that the because this push notification platform, it does not have any idea about what a Intune device object is or what a Azure AD device object is, but it knows the registration which the device made with it. So Intune will generate a push using that registration ID, where the push notification platform will go ahead and instruct the device to wake up the DM client, which is your company portal app. Now, if the device is online, it will receive the notification and the company portal app will go ahead and initialize a device management session with Intune, and it will retrieve the instructions from Intune. The instructions are in the format of XML, which we basically call SyncML. The OMADM protocol itself is the protocol that the company portal and the Intune is using for the communication, where the instructions are sent in the XML standard of SyncML. Once the company portal app receives the DM instructions, it is the company portal app which is invoking the OS functions as per the instructions. For Windows, it's same that it goes to the notification services, the Windows notification server, which will invoke the OMA DM client. the OMADM client will initialize the session and retrieve the instructions in the SyncML format. Now here, why we can see in a bit deeper level is there. Once the OMADM client receives the instruction, it will invoke the configuration service providers, what is there. And then the CSP is the responsible entity of applying that feature in the device. So the communication of a device with Intune is always on demand. Device always maintains an active connection with the push notification servers or the platform services if the device is online. But the connection of the device with the Intune or the management server is always on demand. It's not active always. So when Intune requests the device to be notified that there is a policy change, Intune will generate a push. Else the client, the OMADM client on the devices are configured in a way that they will reach out to Intune every 8 hours by default. I believe so. Yeah, that was the last slide. So before that, I just want to show you something about here. So when I talked about the SyncML, how device gets the instruction. So this particular thing that you are seeing here is basically how Intune instructs the device that there is an MSI application that needs to be installed on the device. So this particular loc URI provides the or instructs the OMADM client which CSP it needs to invoke. So this application, MSI application, is coming down to the device as a device targeted application. So there is /device, and the OMADM client will invoke the enterprise desktop app management CSP, which will then handle this particular request. So once the device receives the instruction from Intune, it also sends a status that, okay, I have received this. But Intune does not send the instruction just like that. So whenever Intune sends the instruction to the device, it will also generate a get instruction to get the status of that particular instruction. So the device will report back the status like this. This is the status for the get command, that it is a 200 OK, means the device has received and acknowledged and invoked the particular CSP, that is the Enterprise Desktop App Management CSP. And it will also send the status, like whether the application status, the data, has it been successful or not. So this basically is something like, so these are the values. 70 means are successfully installed, 10 is initialized, 2 is download in progress. And this is how the device reports continuously back to the server or Intune. And that is where you see in the status that it is pending or it is in progress. In progress is generally it does not show, so it's either pending, success, and failed. And how you do this is basically on your device. If you go ahead and open the registry, so every CSP has a particular registry path. So this is the Enterprise Desktop App Management CSP registry path, where it will have all the MSI applications installed, and this is the status 70 that the device is reporting back to Intune. And when I told about the DM tree, so before initializing a DM session, Intune always queries about all the CSPs that are available for the device. So it queries the device manageability CSP to find what are all the capabilities that can be managed by Intune, based on which the Intune returns a result that, okay, this device has this particular CSPs available. So then based on that, Intune can go ahead and send the instruction to the device. So, yep, this completes my session for today. And if there are questions now, like if I can answer, then I would definitely do that. If not, then we would obviously give you the answers back, but on a later point of time. So this is now the Q&A session. Like if you have any questions, you can just go ahead and ask.
Uh, So now we are getting certificates for Intune. I mean, our certificate store. We have three certificates. So what happens if it expires? So it will automatically create it.
Certificates. When you say if that is a escape certificate, or when you create a certificate on Intune or the certificate profile, you also specify the renewal threshold there. So say the validity period of a certificate is 1 year, and if you mention that 20% renewal threshold, so when the certificate lifetime reaches to that threshold value, Intune will start checking for the renewal feature, and if the load of the connector is perfectly fine. So there are some throttlings in the back end of Microsoft, which Microsoft manage for every tenant, and it's different for every tenant. Based on that, it will get automatically renewed. So Intune will send an instruction for the renewal, where the device will again reach out to the Endless server with the escape request, and it will renew the certificate back.
Sorry, I was dropped. Hello, Ken. So I was asking, so we have three certificates in our certificate store. So what happens if certificate got expired? So if that has a specific, you know, expiry date. So one is for 10 years and another for, I think it's a yearly base certificate, those P2P, those certificates. So how it...
You are talking about the device certificates.
Yeah.
The device certificates will get automatically renewed by Intune, but there has been instances where Intune has failed to renew those device certificates because of some issues in the backend, where you can see the advisories in the service help desk where devices are failing to get renewed their device certificates. So in such cases, Microsoft releases a hot fix or patch, but most of the cases you have to re-enroll the device back. But in general, like say, I can say 70%, the device certificates get automatically renewed.
Okay. And for the failure, I mean, everything we can check in event, right? Event viewer.
Yeah, for the event viewer. Yeah. So
that's the only place.
It's again like when the certificate will get expired or it is expiring, you will get the error events in the AAD events as well as in the user device registration events that the certificate is not valid anymore.
Okay. And the whole flow you just discussed, is it somewhere logged, or I mean, how we can you see the whole flow in device or in Intune?
No, this flow you cannot see, so you have to join the bits and pieces. So like I said, like I took a network trace, and then you have to match the different events. So like it's always starting from the authentication from the AD events to the Azure AD joiner registration process, that is the user device registration events, and finally to the Intune enrollment, that is the enterprise device management provider event. So when you join all the pieces together, you get the flow as a complete thing.
Post commands are running in backend. Those we can see via network trace only. Those are not logged in Event Viewer, right?
Yeah, those are not logged. So you need to take a network trace for that to see.
Okay.
Yeah. And if you are doing that with Fiddler, I would suggest you do not do that with Fiddler, because in order to take a network trace with Fiddler, you have to install the Fiddler trust certificate on the device, which makes your device untrusted with Microsoft. So you can either go for a netmon trace or a ETL trace from the device, or do Wireshark. But with Fiddler, you will not be able to get the Windows trace.
Okay. Thank you.
Joy, for autopilot troubleshooting, do you suggest any command or any steps to see what's happening or where it is stuck in case of issue?
In case of autopilot issue, so basically you get that. Say if the mostly what you will get is a ESP timeout, and there you have the option to collect logs. What it basically does, it collects log from just a minute. It basically collects the log from this particular registry. Okay, so there is a registry path actually which I cannot recall at this moment, but that particular registry is basically used to run the events and everything. And if you click on that get logs or collect logs, then you get the complete set of events where you can see. So again, as I stated, like, you need to check through the series of events. So if you check the user device registration and you see that the join request was successful, then you can move on to the next, that is the Intune enrollment. And in the Intune enrollment, if you see that the enrollment is successful, then basically or probably your device might have failed because a Win32 application has failed or something like that. In that case, you need to move on to the IME logs and all those things. So it's a step of a sequence of activity that you need to follow. But when an error occurs on the device during the provisioning, what it does is it also tells you an error code. So the first point of action is to check the error code in online to see what that refers to, because there is a good bit of chances that you will see it already there present in various blogs, and you can get to the root of the issue directly. Otherwise, yeah, you need to actually go through all the events to find out the root cause.
Okay, for the MDM diagnostic, when we click that collect log, it actually goes to the blank, so it does not.
The MDM diagnostics, if you do that, it actually saves your diagnostic logs to here, and it's in C users public profile. Here in public documents, you will see that. So it gets created here. And there is also, I believe there was one blog from Anoop sir as well about running the MDM diagnostics from the PowerShell or the command line, stating the provisioning area, like MDM diagnostics / area equals to autopilot, and it will give you all the things regarding to that. So you can refer to that. I believe Anoop sir can provide you with the link of that blog. So basically, when you are in the out-of-box experience provisioning for autopilot, pressing the Shift F10 gives you the command prompt option. So you can run a command line instruction there.
Okay, thank you.
So if there are not any further questions, then I believe we are good to call an end to this session. And I hope you were able to learn something today about the flows and have your basics of the enrollments and the steps of what the workflow actually is a bit clarified, which I hope would eventually help you in your day-to-day job roles or activities that you perform. Because the only motive that we take these sessions is to help clarify how the things are working, rather than just go ahead and say how to configure the things. Because it's easy that you can learn how to configure things, but it is very difficult, and that is also a required thing, that you need to know how the things are actually working in the backend when you configure something. So that was all the motive of this session.
Thank you, Joy. It was wonderful session. Even I was not aware of a lot of stuff you explained. So it was awesome. As somebody mentioned in the comment as well, right? So thank you very much. And virtual claps for your detailed explanations, right? So if anybody wants to kind of clap, they can unmute and clap, no issues, right? So I really appreciate Joy.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. Right. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Joy.
Thank you, Joy.
Thanks, Joy.
Thank you all for joining in today, and probably we'll continue next week, same time, same place, right? So enjoy your rest of the evening, probably, right?
Thank you.